my behalf, I requested the patient, next presentation will be this patient, toxic epidermal necrolysis. He is working in Anjaneya temple. Sir, in the Nalemukala, na koila vele. I just showed the patient after our treatment. Thanks,
thank you for the updates. We move on to toxic epidermal necrolysis. May I request Dr. G. R. Mahadevan and Dr. D. Srinivas to present their topic.
Good evening, everyone. I am going to start with a quote: a desire to take medication is perhaps the greatest feature that distinguishes man from other animals. This is a quote from Sir William Oster. So we should all be thankful for that, because without the desire to take medication, we doctors and the entire pharma industry will be out of business. Now, drugs have lengthened our lifespans, shortened the duration of the disease, and if not making disease absolutely painless, has made it relatively pain-free. The downside is drugs have caused death and maimed people. We are going to look at one such disease, a potentially fatal condition, toxic epidermal necrolysis. Is it very common? No, it is not. The incidence is 0.4 to 1.4 million per year, which means that in a city like Chennai, whose population is 10.361 million as on date, according to Google, we are going to see only 10 patients of 10, which is toxic epidermal necrolysis. And in a country like India, we are going to have only 1,300 per year. This patient was referred to me by Dr. Mani Arun, former president, and came with macular erythematous lesions on the trunk and extremities. There was no fever then, and there was no mucous membrane involvement. So I made out a diagnosis of erythema multiforme, and I asked him to come back in about 4 days' time. He came back 4 days later with full-blown toxic epidermal necrolysis. He had vesiculobulous lesions, practically involving the whole body, and lesions involving the mucous membrane as well, the oral mucous membrane as well as the genital mucous membrane, and then he had eye lesions as well. So I referred him to the hospital where our young colleague Dr. Mahadevan is working. And he is going to take over and then tell us what we did to him.
Thank you, sir. I thank IMA Kodambakkam for this opportunity. So as Dr. Srinivasan sir said, this patient came to me with lesions all over the body. So he's a 60-year-old male, known hypertensive on CAD on his regular medications. He was working in Hanuman temple. He was survived by his wife and two daughters. He came with extensive lesions all over the body. And here you can see this is the day of admission where the mouth is completely involved, the lips, the palate, the tongue, and the nose mucous membrane is completely involved. So the patient it was very difficult task to make him examine him in his oral cavity. In one instant, you will feel as if looking at a burns patient where extensively it is involved, and you can see a lot of skin necrosis. And you can see multiple stages of skin lesions at the same time. You can see a normal skin till about skin peeling. The patient is unable to eat anything, cannot even take a sip by mouth. and all the limb movements are restricted due to severe pain. The patient is having severe rigidity due to pain and is unable to get up by himself, is not able to turn by himself, and he just looks at you in a helpless situation. And general physical examination is very toxic and tachycardic, tachypneic, and his BP was on the lower side, his febrile. Luckily, his oxygenation level was okay, and his ABG showed severe metabolic acidosis and mild altered liver enzymes. And he is complaining of pain. He can't even talk, he's just looking at you helpless, and this is where we stand. And he was admitted in the ICU, was seen by all the multidisciplinary team. And he was diagnosed as 10 types of epidermal necrosis even before referral. So the SCOT and score on day 1, which I will be explaining in the later slides, was about 3/7. By 3/7, we say a mortality of around 35%. And by day 3, the score was about 2/7. That is, the acidosis part had been corrected by day 2. And routine all tests were done. And for medical legal purpose, we also got a skin biopsy done. Although the diagnosis was point blank, but still we went to the next stage and we asked the plastic surgeon to do a skin biopsy. So, coming to the management. Supportive care was the mainstay, and that was the most difficult part, doing the supportive care. Because we need to nurse the patient, strict aseptic precautions had to be maintained, and we had to maintaining him from infections. New infections was the biggest challenge in this era of hospital acquired infections. And all the hospital staff, including our IRMs, watchman, and we had completely restricted all the attenders. And on day 1, we couldn't place even an IV line, so I had to put a center line where there was not even any skin lesions, and there is no place to even suture the center line. We just had to plaster it there and leave it as it is. So the first 3 days was very tough, as in any case of an extensive burns. We had to do aggressive fluids, and the nutrition was equally important. I put him on total parenteral nutrition for the first 3 days. Oral care has to be taken aggressively, and for all these things, the pain has to be managed. Otherwise, the patient cannot cooperate for any of your these things. So we had to use opioids extensively. A rice tube was placed, and feeds were started by for day 3. And IV antibiotics were used in the first 3 days in view of high grade fever. And later on, when the cultures are all negative, we stopped off the antibiotics. And as a definitive treatment, we started tablet cyclosporin. After a lot of discussions and after going through what would be the best suitable for him in our clinical scenario and according to his financial situation. And we made sure the patient was given a bath daily by warm water with betadine under aseptic precautions. And we used a completely autoclaved, you can see the beshit, what we used there. It is a Veshti which was autoclaved and regularly changed morning and evening. So coming to about pathophysiology, the TEN and SGS, that is the toxic epidermal necrosis and Stevens-Johnson syndrome, are severe life-threatening adverse cutaneous drug reactions which involve the skin and mucous membrane. So we are in the era of a lot of litigations, and we have to be careful about every drug what we use, and we have to be doubly sure asking ourselves whether it is definitely needed or we justified in giving it. We have, all of us have faced a lot small adverse reactions, right, from itching and abdomen pain or vomiting or something. But none of us want to face something like a Stevens-Johnson syndrome or a toxic epidermal necrosis. And by the time we realize it, it is always a late presentation. It is not an immediate presentation. The presentation is always a very delayed hypersensitive reaction. And the patient have a prompt diagnosis and referral center should be very accurate. So they both are two ends of a spectrum where the difference is only the extent of the skin involvement. So we have three phenotypes. Number one is the Stevens-Johnson syndrome, where the extent is about less than 10%. The next one is a TEN-SJS overlap, where the extent about 10 to 30%. The last one is a proper TEN, where it is more than 30% of skin detachment. And the Mycoplasma pneumoniae and herpes simplex virus are also widely documented in the etiology, apart from the drugs. So it is not always the drugs. So to escape ourselves, you know, we also have other etiology by the viruses. So these are the commonly documented drugs: allopurinol, the anti-epileptic drugs, lamotrigine, nevirapine, NSAIDs, basically the oxycom NSAIDs, sulfamethoxazole, other sulfa drugs like dapsone, and the anti-tubercular drugs. So our patient, after repeated probing, the patient's daughter gave us a prescription given by a dermatologist which showed dapsone. We are not sure why it was prescribed, but that was the only thing which was there as a triggering factor, which was taken about 3 weeks back to the patient. So this is the SCOT and score, where each one has 1 point, where the age associated with malignancy, about the heart rate and the urea levels, the skin level, how much of body surface area, serum bicarbonate, is the amount of acidosis, and the blood sugar levels. So if the score of 1, it is about 3% mortality, it's about score of 3 is about 35% mortality, and so on. Coming to the clinical features, as of any other disease, we have prodromal phase where it is all non-specific even before the skin lesions appear. We have fever, headache, arthralgia, difficulty in swallowing, stinging eyes, all like a viral illness it starts off. And fever is the most common thing, and it's not always associated with any other bacterial infections. We have erythematous blisters over 30%, detachment of the full thickness of the epidermis is seen. Scalp is mostly spared. Involvement of the buccal, genital and ocular is seen more than 90% of the patients. Rarely respiratory and GI is involved, and if respiratory system is involved, the patient has had it and the mortality is very high. Coming to the second phase of the disease, epidermal detachment is often seen. You can see, appreciate here, like different levels of skin lesions are there. And this is Nicolsi's sign. It's not a specific sign for toxic epidermal necrosis, but it is mostly it is present. Applying a tangential pressure on the erythematous skin size causes exfoliation. So when you take into the amount of skin involvement, we have to consider both the detachment as well as the Nicolsi sign. The histology, where you can see the necrotic keratinized sites, where the skin is actually, that is a bullous lesion where it is detached from the upper dermis area. Epidermal necrolysis is there, subepidermal bulla, and the lower the dermis was uninvolved. The pathogenesis of TEN is mostly a delayed hypersensitivity reaction. The drug's onset and the reactions can have even a 1 month's time. So we'll have to go through complete history of what the patient has been taking for the last 1 month, or in 2 months for that matter. Drug metabolites binding to the epidermal proteins triggering an immune response caused by the immunoallergic adverse reactions. It's a T cell mediated causing regeneration and necrosis of the drug altered keratinized sites. The fast ligand, perforin and granzyme B, granulysin, all these things are involved, and these levels are all elevated in patients with TEN. These are the differential diagnoses we need to keep in mind: autoimmune blistering diseases, linear IgA dermatosis, bullous fixed drug eruption, acute generalized exanthematous pustulosis, Staphylococcus calyxin syndrome, and paraneoplastic pemphigus. Coming to the management, identification of the drug and prompt withdrawal is very, very important. An initial assessment of ABC, airway, breathing, circulation, prompt referral to the appropriate center, supportive care as we have already seen, and appropriate investigations, initiation of the disease modifying therapy, and prevention of any recurrences. So when do we use antibiotics in these patients? It is always a question of debate, because most of the patients are febrile, they are toxic. Sometimes they are also hypothermic because most of the skin layer is not there. So the patient can go in for even severe hypothermia. So a patient with high bacterial count with a single strain from the skin or the culture sample of the catheter, and sudden hypothermia in a relatively stable patient, a confused mental state, anxiety and excitement, symptoms of infection pertaining to any particular like a cellulitis or a pneumonia or urinary tract infection, which is clinically made. And these are the disease modifying. Here you can see the skin lesions. This is probably about the day 7 or 8 here. So systemic steroids have been extensively studied with an equivocal response. Cyclosporine A has been extensively studied, and there is a benefit, mortality benefit is there. IVIG, plasma paracetamol, cyclophosphamide, all with again equivocal response, there is no mortality benefit. Etanercept and infliximab have been quoted in a few studies with a mortality benefit. Pentoxifilin and thalidomide, again with no benefit. So with this patient, we started cyclophosphamide by day 1 itself, and it works by inhibiting the CD4 and the CD8 cells in the epidermis by suppressing the interleukin-2 production. The dose recommended is about 3 to 5 mg per kg body weight and divided doses of 7 days. And etanercept and infliximab have shown a survival benefit. So this patient, after about 3 weeks of struggle, we could shift him to the ward. We were there for the ward for about 3 days and we successfully sent him home. So as Dr. Mani said, we were discussing about the pathophysiology and this thing, but the psychosocial impacts of the disease, a patient who is completely disfiguring, and how do we convince him that, you know, he will get better, and eventually, sometimes we ourselves, we are in the benefit of doubt, what is going to be the prognosis. So Dr. Mani helped us really in the counseling of the patient. Every day he used to counsel them for about 30 minutes, he used to counsel me for about 10 minutes, that you don't worry, you take, you know. He will definitely come out, we are going in the right direction, and he gave me a lot of confidence. And whether fortunately or unfortunately, I had two other patients of toxic epidermidecrosis the same year. So she is a 65-year-old lady, she is a nurse, she is a retired nurse. She had an atypical pneumonia. She came to New York Hospital after about 1 week, and she got back home, the pneumonia all settled back. Within 3 days, she comes with extensive lesions and involving the mucus, this thing, and clinically it was a typical toxic epidermal necrosis. The family was so supportive. I had to narrate my previous experience with the patient Palani, and I have told them that she would go back home there, and she went back without any organ damage or any lung involvement. And this is again a young lady, which about 25 years old. I couldn't find what was the culprit drug. She also went back home without any complications. Thank you.
Can streptococcal toxic shock syndrome manifest like this, or it's different completely?
It can manifest like this, sir. It can have extensive bullous lesions.
So then how do you differentiate?
Actually, staphylococcus carpetian syndrome.
Streptococcal toxic shock syndrome.
Yeah, it's called SSSS, staphylococcal cadaver skin syndrome. It is an extensive infection caused by staphylococcus, usually seen in children, and not very common in adults, and it is not drug induced. And when we, there are only sheets of skin getting peeled off with very few involvement of the mucous membrane.
Mucous membrane?
Yes, there's hardly any involvement, it's only the skin. Here, you don't diagnose toxic epidermal necrolysis unless two mucosal sites are involved apart from the skin. So it can be the commonest ones that are involved are the oral mucous membrane, then the eye is involved, the third is the genital, and lastly is the anal mucous membrane. So the skin involvement along with two mucosal membrane sites, and over 30% of the skin has to be involved before a diagnosis of TEN is made. So below that is only a Stephen Johnson's or a Stephen Johnson's bar TEN overlap. And if it is only 20% and below, it is only Stephen Johnson's.
See, I don't want to take much credit from them saying that I was doing counseling and counseling with others. But the very fact that I want to share one information. Dr. Charles Sagal used to ask me every time, bombard me, what is the success rate of alcoholism? This person whom you saw, his father was an alcoholic. I treated him, but I failed. He was so scared because he was having three daughters. He came to me for 2 days counseling. Believe it or not, it's unbelievable. He quit alcohol. He retired from Britannia. He got married all the three daughters. One fine day he came to my clinic. I used to have a passport size photograph underneath the table. He asked me, can you give this? I said, what for? I want to keep it in front of the God because you saved me. I performed all the three daughters' marriage. Now he has been working in Hanuman Koi temple after the Britannia company closed, right? I used to every day walk via that one. Unfortunately, he landed up with this. I told Magadev will not be up-treated. It's only Anjaneya restricted.
I'd just like to take 30 seconds. This is my second patient with toxic heptaban necrolysis. The previous one was 1981, and we lost a patient in 4 days' time. At that time, there was no ICU, no cyclosporin, and we had to give the patient only steroids. And she had about close to 100% skin involvement. And the physician was lamenting that he could not even take the BP.
The first patient which we saw the patient from Maya Nursing Home, the other two patients from Maya Myanmar.
We request Dr. Mani to give two certificates of appreciation to Dr. Mahadevan and to Dr. B. Srinivas.
WhatsApp
group.